2 Corinthians 2, chapter 2, verse 14. The King James Version says it this way. Thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ. Always. Not sometimes, not on the weekends, not in the mornings. Always. And who's causing us to triumph? He is. It's not on our own strength. Oh, we've got to agree. Our will is involved. But He is the active ingredient. He always causes us to triumph in Christ. The New King James says it this way. He always leads us in triumph in Christ. And now listen. And through us, who? Everybody say us. Through us diffuses the fragrance of His knowledge in every place. Through who? Through us. In every place, His fragrance, He's diffusing it through us. In the New Living Translation, verses 14 and a couple more verses, He says, He uses us to spread the knowledge of Christ everywhere. Like a sweet perfume. Our lives are a Christ-like fragrance rising up to God, but this fragrance is perceived differently by those who are being saved and by those who are perishing. To those who are perishing, we're a dreadful smell of death and doom. But to those who are being saved, we are a life-giving perfume. Who's a life-giving perfume? You are. Let me give you a quote from Bill Johnson. Jenny shared this with me a couple days ago. He says, quote, Bill Johnson, the pastor of the Bethel Church up in Reading, he says, quote, the Spirit of the resurrected Christ lives in us. And as soon as He took up residence in us, God expected us to conquer something. Who's supposed to conquer something? We are. The power of that living Spirit within us, but who's supposed to conquer something? Who? Okay, we're getting it. The moment that Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead took up residence in me, all of heaven began to look to see what is He going to do with what He has been given. He's just been given the exact same presence, the exact same power that raised Jesus from the dead. It's not, this is continuing in this quote from Bill Johnson. It's not typology. It's not symbolic. It's the actual real deal. The Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is alive in me. He's alive in you. He is in us and He wants out. Now listen to this. He is a river in us, not a lake. Certainly not a swamp. He is in us as a river, not a lake. End quote. Luke 19, verse 13 says, and He called His 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds. Wish He'd deliver me of 10 pounds. And delivered them 10 pounds. That word 10 pounds is translated minas, pennies, talents. It's an amount of currency. And then He said unto them, occupy until I come. The English Standard Version translates it this way: engage in business until I come. Everybody say engage. 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 Father, in the name of Jesus, thank You today for the opportunity to come and to gather to give you our praise and our worship. Thank you for responding, even as you promised, Lord, by dwelling in the midst of your praises. Thank you, Lord. And today I ask you that this word will go forth in a manner which will meet the need, heal the broken heart, instruct and direct us on this journey, Father. And Lord, as we start out this new year, I pray for our country. I pray for President Obama. I pray, Lord, that you will visit him and lead him to fullness of life. We pray for President-elect Trump, for Vice President-elect Pence. We pray for the cabinet. We pray for the Congress. We pray for our governments across this nation. We ask you, Lord, restore the truth of the word as the principles and guiding directions for this country, Lord. We ask this in the name of Jesus. And everyone who agrees says,
amen.
Amen. We have a tremendous opportunity before us. A tremendous opportunity to make a difference. A difference for the kingdom of God. Here in our county, in our state, in our country, in the world, in our families, in our church. We have an opportunity to make a difference. Who's we? Little old us? Miwok Village? Who in the heck has heard of Miwok Village, right? This would seem a bit presumptuous for me to make such a bold statement that we, Word of Life Fellowship, Miwok Village, have an opportunity to make a difference in the kingdom of God in this world. It would be presumptuous if it wasn't a challenge and a promise to all of Christianity. We're all supposed to be making a difference in our community, our family, our churches, our state, country, and the world. We're supposed to make a difference. It just so happens that this place, and many of you right here, have received specific prophetic words of promise and challenge to make a difference. You have. That's why that song makes so much, means so much to us. I believe in the promises he's spoken over us. Doubt will not defeat me. Death will not defeat me. I'll not give in to fear, but we will rise up and believe and walk in the promises of God. Things have just been happening. I mean, 12 years ago, we just look at those prophecies and go, yeah, right. How's that ever going to happen? Today, we have our own Don Wilk living in Madagascar. We're preaching all over the world. It is happening, folks. Just 3 weeks ago, Celine and I got an invitation to go to the Christian Inaugural Gala in Washington, D.C. for the night before the presidential inauguration. If you know me, you know we're no great leaders, not that the issue. But God has promised, God's challenged us to rise up and to make a difference. I don't know what's going to happen. I won't know if I don't go. So we're going. I want to make it clear that I don't endorse the lifestyles or many of the lifestyles of our president-elect. But I am excited about the change that is promised to happen in Washington, D.C. And I believe God is going to be faithful to his word if I'll get up off of my butt and do what Jackie said, be obedient to God, and go and see what God does. See if we have opportunity to render influence. So we're going to go. So keep praying for us. Pray for our governors, pray for our congressmen, pray for our senators, pray for our president. We need, I mean, it could be a very dangerous time. There's a lot of people very up in arms, very upset about this stuff, and we can joke about them whining about losing or whatever the case might be, but it's dangerous, and we need to continue to pray. So please join us in that thing. But the point is, we have an opportunity to do something and make a difference. Will we rise up and do it? I believe this year that the Lord is giving us a new and a rich word. Last year, he told us to pursue him, to chase after him so as to catch him, to come higher. He had more for us. He taught us in the last part of the year that we are overcomers. We are overcomers, not because we have overcome, but because that's who we were born to be. The statement, the certification of being an overcomer, it's not a certificate of accomplishment yet. It's a birth certificate. We're overcomers because we're designed and born to be overcomers. That's who we are. And I believe God's word this year, the start off this year, is to engage. He's inviting us. He's challenging us. And starting with today, the instruction is beginning to engage our community, to be salt and light, to be the aroma, the fragrance of Christ in our community, to those all around us, and to a new degree, to a new extent, to a new magnitude. Increase. I loved it. I saw a few of those words, but they didn't know anything about what I'd prepared, what the Lord gave me for today. I love it when a plan comes together. More than ever before, we need the Lord. More than ever before, we need his presence. We need his word. We need the Logos word. We need the Rhema word. We need his spirit directing us and guiding us. It only comes. How does it come? What does the Bible say? That's going to be my favorite question of 2017. What does the Bible say? Seek me with your whole heart and you will find me. Seek me with prayer and fasting, and I will be found of you, Jeremiah said. This is how we started off the first of the year. And I want to thank all of you who joined us. We had a great turnout. I know many of you can't, and that's understandable. But even those who have illnesses and pregnancies and so forth, which is not an illness, even those who couldn't fast, at least you skipped the donuts until yesterday. I love the way Pastor Celine breaks a fast. Hey, Ronnie Lee, bring dozens of donuts. Okay, I had an apple. Really, I did. I didn't have a donut, no. Mainly because I was too slow to get over there, I think. You know, they were gone, boom. Whew. But prayer and fasting makes a difference. Let me say that again. Prayer and fasting makes a difference. Did you notice the energy from this worship team today? Did you feel and sense the power of God's presence today? I mean, we went up another notch. Ah, geez, I wonder if it has anything to do with the fact that we just fasted for a week. I believe it is. I believe when you pray, when you fast, God hears and he moves. God hears and he moves. I want to thank each and every one of you for coming and joining us and being a part. It makes a difference. I believe, this is a little side note, I believe that when history is fully revealed in eternity, whether we go there or he comes here, whichever is first, when we get a chance standing in eternity to look back at history and see everything, the invisible and the visible, I believe the invisible is more than the visible. But when we get a chance to look back and see all of it, we're going to find that the millions of the movers and shakers and those who have shaped policy and decisions were the intercessors and the prayer warriors, and probably more than the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. Because the fivefold ministry, they work at the bidding of heaven. But the intercessors partner with heaven. I believe that we're going to see that the intercessors made the lion's share of difference. We must pray. We must continue to seek God. And then God will accomplish what he's challenging us to rise and do. Do I hear an amen? The word of the Lord this year is engage. To be engaged by the Lord, to engage ourselves, turn on the switch, and to engage others, other people, other things, other parts of our community. To be engaged by the Lord, to engage ourselves, and to engage others. And we can do all three of these things. We can do all three of these because God first engaged us. We can love because He first loved us. And we are not going to be able to do this if He didn't initiate this stuff. That's the huge difference between Christianity and all of the other religions of the world. They preach a cosmic distant deity waiting for His people to do religious endeavors to reach Him. But our God knew that we couldn't do anything on our own, that we were dead in trespasses and sin, and He sent His Son Jesus to die for us so that we could live. He initiated it. He engaged with us. Therefore, we can do all of what He's called us to do. We can engage because He first engaged us. Jesus came to this earth and He engaged it. Jesus came to this earth. He didn't just do a flyover. He didn't come and just do His cosmic magic show. He didn't come to inspect in preparation for judgment. He came into the earth, God in man, and He died on the cross for us. He died and He rose from the dead so that we could have freedom from sin, forgiveness, cleansing, and freedom from the power of sin. He engaged humanity at every level. Every level. And now we are His ambassadors. Those of us that believe in Him, those of us who have received Him as Savior and Lord, He instantly, the moment you received Him, He instantly translates you out of that place of death, out of that place of darkness, and places you into the kingdom of His dear Son. He makes us in that instant. He makes us sons. He makes us daughters, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. We become His ambassadors. We become the fragrance of Christ. We become His representatives. Or as Dutch Sheets likes to say, we become those that represent Him. That's us. It's our turn to engage. 2 Corinthians, where'd it go here? 2 Corinthians, it went away. Jesus came to engage the world. I like the way John Bevere says it. He says, Jesus made it easy to come, but hard to stay. Jesus made it easy to come, but hard to stay. Jesus said, come, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And then He challenged them to eat His flesh and drink His blood. Jesus said, come, all you who thirst, and I will give you water, rivers of living water. And then He said, love not the world, and rebuke them for greed in the world. Then He said, forgive your enemies. Then He said, you're going to hate your mother and your brother and your sister because I want you to love Me. Then He said, take up your cross and follow Me. Jesus made it easy to come and hard to stay. He engaged the world. And now He's calling us. He's calling us to engage the world. He's given us everything we need. Now it's our move. It's our turn. Matthew 28:18 says, then Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Me. And Luke 10:19 says, I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy. Going on in Matthew 28, verse 19 through 20, He says, therefore go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. First He gave the authority. Then He's challenging us to engage. Did you notice that? First he gives, then he challenges us to engage. 2 Peter 1. First he gives us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Everything we need to be able to rise up and let this Holy Spirit out to manifest the life. He gives us everything we need, and then he challenges us to give all diligence to make our calling and election sure. First he gives, and then he challenges us to engage. He gives first, then he challenges. He's given us everything we need, and now he's expecting us to conquer something. Wonder what they're going to do with all the stuff we gave them. What does it mean to engage? The answer to that question is another question. What does the Bible say? It sounds cute, sounds funny, but that is one of the main flaws in the moral fabric of our nation. Is people are looking everywhere else for the answers to what should I do, how should I live, who should I work with, be with, what the answer should always be. What does the Bible say? So what is engage? What does it mean to occupy? What does the Bible say? The old King James word occupy, it doesn't mean today what it meant 400 years ago when the translators put it together. The Strong's Bible, Strong's Concordance says that the word, it's got 14 or 15 letters in here in the Greek, but the word translated means to busy oneself. That is to trade, to do business. It's a verb, and the noun from which it comes, it means a deed, business, a business matter, a thing, work. Other translations shed light on what this word engage means. Because we can get up and shout it all day long, but if we don't know what he's telling us to do, what good is it? Engage! So what does that mean? Well, like I said, the English Standard Version uses the word engage. The Amplified says, buy and sell with these things while I go and then return. I find it interesting. We heard these words of prophecy about what God's given us. All of this we're supposed to do, with what God has already given us. I don't know about you, but half the time when someone asks me to do something, I turn around and ask him for more than what I already have. Hey, or can you take care of this for me, Pat? Yeah, well, I could use some more of this. No, I've already given you everything you need. Now you need to take care of that. But so often I focus on what I don't have instead of what I do have. But God is saying, I've given you everything you need. And all of these verbs are telling us to engage with what we have until I come back. Buy and sell with these while I go and then return. Another translation says, do business with these till I come. The CEV translation says, use this to earn more money until I get back. The Message Bible says, operate with this until I return. The NIV says, put this money to work until I come back. The NLT says, invest this for me. Engage. Engage. The word engage means to attract. It means to attract or involve someone's interest or attention. To pledge or enter into a contract to do something. To engage, to participate, to become involved in. It means to engage with establish a meaningful contact or connection with. One of these makes reference like in a piece of machinery, so it's like an allegory or illustration. It means to move into position so as to come into operation, like engage the clutch. He engaged the gears and pulled out onto the road, right? One of these translations says, move into position, enter into conflict and combat with an enemy. Now, let me say those again, but I want you to put the name Jesus in front of it. And right next to Jesus, I want you to put your name in front of it. Jesus attracted and involves someone's interest and attention. Jesus pledged. He entered into a contract. What's another word for contract? Covenant. Jesus entered into a covenant to do something, to give us life and life more abundantly. Jesus engaged in, he participated and became involved in. He was involved and engaged at the most intimate level of relationship with his people. Jesus established a meaningful contact and connection. He established a contract as well. He moved into position and came ready into operation. And without a doubt, he entered into conflict and combat with an enemy. And he defeated that enemy. He broke the power of death, hell, and sin. And he made it possible for each and every one of us to be able to engage and be engaged with him and the kingdom of God. He did that for us. He provided for everything we need. The point is, he came into this world and engaged humanity at every level. He equipped us, and he's now challenging us to take our step, our place, to engage in this world just as he did. We are the fragrance of Christ to this world. We are his ambassadors. We are his representers. He first gave, now he's challenging. So folks, I'm here to just tell you flat out, straight up, it's time to engage. The spirit of that resurrected Christ lives in us. Let me say that again from Bill Johnson. As soon as he took up residence in us, God expected us to conquer something. When it took up residence, all of heaven began to look down and see, what is he going to do with what we gave him? Ladies and gentlemen, 2017, that is the challenge before us. What are we going to do with what God has given us? What I see is a group of people here who are really starting to realize what God is doing in their life. They're starting to see who God has made them to be. They're beginning to understand. You guys are beginning to understand that you're already overcomers. You're beginning to understand that this life of God is in you. We're beginning to see what God has called us to do, and we're starting to rise up. That's who I'm looking at. And I want to tell you how proud I am to be able to walk with you, because this year we're going to see a difference being made. We're going to see it right here in Tuolumne County. We're going to see it happening in this state. We're going to see it. But we've got to do our part. We've got to do our part. And before I close, I talked about this guy Jesus. I talked about if we will believe in him and receive him as Savior and Lord, that we will become sons and daughters of God. Today, I don't want the day to go without extending an invitation to anybody who is here who has never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. I want to ask Carrie and Kathy or whoever else is on the piano to get up there and sing a song. But I want to give an invitation and give an opportunity. If you have never received Jesus Christ, I don't want the day to pass if you would like to ask him to be your Savior. If you're uncomfortable about coming up in an altar call thing, that's fine. I'll linger here afterwards. I'll linger here and wait. You come in, I'll be more than happy to pray for you. But I want you to have the opportunity to know Jesus as your Savior and know him as your Lord. Because God is doing something in this earth today. It is the most fabulous and the greatest time in the history of humanity. Yes, darkness is coming upon the earth and darkness upon the people. But God is causing his people to rise up And the light and the life that is within his people is getting ready to start to shine. And it's happening right now. It's the culmination of the age, and God is moving. And I wouldn't want to miss out on this for anything. If you don't know Jesus, please, please feel free to come up and talk to me. Come up and talk to me. But I also want to talk to Word of Life. There's a lot of you who feel completely disqualified to engage in anything. I love what Liz, I love these prophecies. These were great. We're going to get them printed up, make them available so you can take them home, have them with you to pray. But this is a year where depression is going to be a part of our past. This is a year when disqualification or the lie of it is going to be a part of your past. If you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you have been filled with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, if you've been water baptized, then you are, now are we the sons of God. It does not yet appear what we're going to look like, but we're going to look like Him when we see Him. That is what 2017 has to offer you. And I want to ask, if you are in that category, if you feel that you are too, you've gone too far, you've done too much, you've screwed up too big, I'm here to tell you that that's a lie of the devil and that he was defeated. Jesus engaged him and defeated him. And you do not need to succumb to that. And today, I want to pray for you. My wife, Celine, is going to pray with us. Carl, I want you to come as well. Mike Murtaugh, if you will. And if you are in that state, if you are in that condition, if you are the audience of the liar of your soul, the enemy of your soul, and he's been feeding you that nonsense, today I want to do my part to break him off of you so that he won't whisper in your ear anymore. Or if he does, you'll know where to tell him to go. Straight to hell. Right back where you came from. Because God's people are being called to rise up and engage this world, this community, and make a difference. And that's you. If you hear my voice, you're part of that group.